Good afternoon, it's David Weegenaar here. It's 2:28 on my PC. This is a position between H Donna and another player. And this position occurred in 1957, I thought it was correct. His opponent is Duck Stein. And it's in some place, I can't pronounce it, it's like my name, Wageningen. Anyway, and so this is the position that black is to move, and when you know the result, or when you know how white did what they did, you'll say it's very, very easy, but it wasn't very easy for white's opponent, Duck Stein, to see the continuation that Donna found at the board, which is quite remarkable, but it's almost simplistic, but it's quite nice at the same time. So anyway, and I, as well as that, I've got my mother on the phone, and like I spoke earlier on, that I think it's my mother that actually taught me chess. I'm suspecting that it might have been my mother that taught me chess, not my oldest sister. So, and anyway, she's on the line now, and she's got some things to say, maybe. Maybe I don't like to hear all the things she's got to say, but anyway, here she is here. So if you want to hear what she's got to say, and if she doesn't want to say anything, then I'll just count that as I'll have to do the video all over again. But here she is here. I know.
No. I'd be just better hanging up there, Fritz.
You better hang
I
up.
I really don't know what to say.
Okay. Okay. But you can confirm I met the Queen, can't you?
No.
No, you can't.
I'm very
she can't remember.
I'm very proud of people who can play chess and play chess well.
Ah, so you're very proud of people that can play chess and play chess well. So am I. I'm really, really impressed with people that can play chess well. And I'm not talking about myself there. I'm talking about people that can really play chess really well, like Bobby Fischer could, and Garry Kasparov, and Magnus Carlsen, even if he loses here and there a game, just a skittles game. I'm really impressed with that sort of player like Magnus Carlsen. Okay, so anyway, I'll get going, Mum, and I'll continue with the session. Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Bye bye.
Yeah,
and thank you to all those people to hear my mother. That's my mother in Dunedin, in New Zealand, Dunedin. So that's my mother who's 91 in June. Okay. Thank you. Bye, Mum. So she said, Rolt Rister or something like that, which means rest well in Dutch. Now anyway, this position here, and it's the 10th of April 2017, the Monday, week 22, the 10th of April 2017. Now here is a position that black is to play, and when you find out the way in which black lost this game, you will say, oh, that's pretty simple to see, but it still takes quite an imagination. A5. Okay, now with this move here, Donna has just played Bishop C7, and he sort of threatens naively B7. Okay, that's what it looks like to black. Is, oh, he wants to play B7, and then I have to take this bishop with my rook here, and then when the pawn takes my rook on C8, I just, and it's queen check or rook check, I just take it back. That's all good. So unbeknown to black, there's something devious about this actual move, which is quite pretty. Black plays A5. Now, the other thing I want to say, that's what I've just said, is rook 2 takes bishop, if pawn to B7, rook 2 takes bishop, not rook 1 takes the bishop, because then it's queen, check, and mate after two moves with the rooks, which lose themselves straight away, to check, check, mate. So that's the threat. So black's just played a5. Correct, however, was the immediate. Correct, however, was the immediate capture rook 2 take c7. Pawn takes, rook takes. Rook e1 threatening, rook e8 checkmate, f6, in that case too white certainly has the better chances, or the best chances, but the situation is not wholly clear. Now this is coming from one of my favorite books, as I've already mentioned, Winning Chess Combinations from Hans Bouwmeester. So I've just been speaking to a Dutch lady on the phone who happens to be my mother, of course, and I just watched some opera singers last night on Blu-ray, and they were incredible, but the Italian singers, and I won't say who they are, but the Italian singers, trio of singers, male singers, so you can just about find out who they are. And I watched their Blu-ray, and one part of it, they say, everyone, there's something that every person from our country loves the most, and that's their mother. Now, let's face it, our mums are just great, eh? The things that they've had to put up with when we were kids, as well as when we were not kids and when we are grown up, and that even when we're still grown up, they still have to put up with things. So anyway, that's all very well, but I was a wee bit touched by that, because I'm in good contact with my mother daily, or almost daily, even though she lives 400 and something odd kilometers away. I often call her on the phone to have a wee yarn with her, and at her age, she's still doing Code Cracker, which and she does it very quick. And her native language, by the way, is Hollands or Nederlands. That's Dutch, but it's not Kiwi or English or anything like that. That's not her first language. In fact, quite the contrary. So for her to be doing Code Crackers and everything like that, that's quite a feat. So it keeps her mind quite active. Anyway, so we're back to this problem that we're looking at, the problem that came about back then, 1957. So it says that a5 is an error, and rook takes bishop straight away is the best move. Now, why is that? Well, okay, right, we're going to find out. Now, here we've got the main line. This is the main line, a5. This is what actually happened. So what did white now play? Here, white plays rook takes bishop, okay? Now there's two lines here for black to play, or three, or something like that. There's three lines to play here. I'm actually wondering about one. Oh no, I'm not. Now what, say black plays rook takes here, okay? What does black get met with then? This move, chomp. And then it's all over, as you can see. Because if the pawn gets to take the rook on d4, it's queen c8 check, or rook c8 check, and rook d8 or queen d8 checkmate the next move. Okay, if the rook takes this pawn here, you can see what the move is for white here is rook d8 checkmate. Okay, I can't go back with the cursor key when it's checkmate, so that doesn't work. Now what about after rook d4 cd4? See, this opponent, this Dutch player Donner, Jan Donner, I think his name is, J.H. Donner, or A, or something, he saw this when he played bishop c7 here, the move before. He saw all this. New variation. If cd4, rook here, and what does black do about the resulting b7 check to the rook? Not much. If black plays this, white can merely play this. And if this, well, then we queen the next move, of course. Even though black's got a pawn on d4. Oops, what did I do there? I don't know what happened there. That's rook d8 line. Oh, good, go back over that. Rook d4. Then, if this one, then that. So we were looking at this, I think, this, and the threat is this, okay? And even though black can push this d pawn, they're not in time because we've got this move here. And really, to be honest, the best move here for black is to run this thing away. Can't take here because of the checkmate, like I've just showed you. So the best thing is to run away, even though it's not great. Black hasn't got time to play d2, threatening queening themselves, for the major reason of pawn takes rook on c8 check with the rook or the queen, which promotes and checkmate thereafter. They can take with a bishop, but it's not what I would. They can take this and make it a bishop, but I would not advise that at all, because if this becomes a bishop, b7, if this becomes a bishop, then this move here is okay for black first. So if we make this a bishop, okay, then white's going to be lost after this. Queen. Now if the king goes up here, it's pretty silly because of a few reasons, which one would be this check here if black so desired. King takes, rook check, king here or here. So if king here, then am I going to see it straight off or am I going to see it later on? We've got queen check, which I saw, of course, if black so desires. And now pawn here is no good because of queen takes pawn, or depending on how you want to play it, queen takes pawn and like this, this and this. Okay, so that's just an example. So it's no good for white to play silly here. I don't know what's taken over now, because it has taken over with my, yeah, there you go. So that's all no good for white to play that way. And this is no good either, because if the rook moves somewhere, like wants to get behind this d pawn to push it, white can, if they feel so such a desire, can just move their king here and here if they really, really want to, but they don't need to. They just go c b7, and the threat is rook here. And so even if black plays this rook here, king here, then merely either rook takes rook, rook d8, or b8 queen, and black's totally lost. Just simply, this pawn runs, okay, fine, we'll just stop it like I've already aforementioned. So with sensible play, white's in a very good position, and in a winning position in that regard. So okay, we've got rook d4. Donna has just played rook d4. So black thinks, fine, right, I'm going to take this. Okay, so this is the new main line. And now, if white plays, I will show you, for you to look at this in your head. If white now plays bc7, taking the rook with the pawn, black's response is not rook takes pawn because of rook d8 checkmate. Okay, you can see all that because it's only a couple moves, it's not hard to do it. And once you get the hang of it, you get better and better at it. So what, and you can do that on the bus or on the train or on the plane or whatever you're on, or the ship or the boat. You can have a diagram position in front of you and analyze it. Just do it. You can do it. You can do it. There's nothing hard about it. If I can do it, you know, I'm not from, my parents were not professors and lawyers and doctors and things like that. My mum was a housewife and she was a cleaner, and my father was a bus driver. And I'm proud as anything of my father, who was a bus driver, because he had a good job. He loved what he did. He got called the Flying Dutchman. So if I can analyze that, this sort of thing, then anyone can. So white's met with this. So if we'll just show you then, if this, which is possible, black does not take this pawn because of rook c7 checkmate. Rook d8 checkmate, sorry, because I've just said rook c7 in my mind. So if rook c7, that's a big blunder because of rook d8 checkmate. But black merely plays pawn takes here. And then what's white going to do here? Okay, that's all very well. Black cannot play this. Let's just say we play a silly move here. Well, black can play it, but it's not what the main line is, because this is threatened rook d8 again, checkmate. But that's not the line. So if bc7, cd4, and black's doing okay. Look, we'll look at it. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 pawns for each. Now look at these three pawns, they're pretty ugly. Now if white gets their rook here straight away, black can either choose or elect to play d3, but I wouldn't, or just merely move their king here, or play pawn here, but that gives white the 7th rank, where black can contest it, but then they have to meet this. So that's no good. So after here, Donna found this move. New mainline, this is what he played. This forces, as you can appreciate, rook d8, because otherwise it's checkmate, but it isn't checkmate because it's not possible because it's not checkmate. But it forces rook takes rook on d8. After the rook d8, it forces rook d8. There's no other move. We can have a look, but there's no other move that black can play in response to rook d8 check, because otherwise the king would lose itself the next move. Then Donna played bc7. Now, what I said to you before is this is quite simplistic, but his opponent didn't see it, but Donna did, and he was one of the top Dutch players of Holland, which is where my mother, that you've just heard, came from The Hague. Den Haag, and my father came from Amsterdam. Okay, that's where Mr. Weegenaar came from, Amsterdam, and they came to New Zealand in 1950. And so now we've got this move, and now what is white going to do? Because they're going to lose this pawn, are they? Not such. Now this causes immediate resignation from black. The only survival, other than rook takes pawn, is king here. All other moves are futile. You can't go here because of rook d8 check, and then if you like c takes d8 rook or queen checkmate, or even bishop if you want to play that endgame. But then you might make it the game last a bit longer, but if you want to, you can do it. Just if you want to keep playing the game of chess here at hand, then you can do into a bishop and you probably will still win, even though you make it a wee bit difficult, because you'll be ending up with these three tripled pawns isolated, and this pawn here and this pawn here. Now I can still win that for white, but it's not what I recommend. So if rook here, then rook here, and then it's either queen here next move, or rook takes rook, and queen check, and queen takes pawn, and queen takes pawn, and queen here, and or take this pawn, blah blah blah, and queen can go here and here if it likes, and you can dribble the king along here and up here and all that sort, whatever you like. But it's not what we're doing here. We're not talking about the absolute possibilities in chess. We're talking about what are the finite responses in general, and what can black do about this. Now, so we've got this position here. What can black do? Okay, they can give themselves a square for their king, okay, but only to be met with rook d8 check, And if rook takes rook, then either pawn takes rook, queen, check, or rook, check, or bishop, promoted to a bishop, or to a knight. And as I've said before, in lightning chess, you have to promote it to something. You, the actual player who's promoting the pawn, has to actually do the promotion yourself physically, not your opponent. Now, I used to think the other way around about it, but I was incorrect. Your opponent does not have to do the promotion, you do. But your opponent cannot hide the pieces and that sort of thing. They're not allowed to do that. But it happens, don't you worry about that. So here we've got, this is a decisive winning advantage, even if it becomes a knight or a bishop, it's still winning for white, but it's harder. But I'm talking about just normal situation here. Rook d8 check, black's going to probably want to play this. Now if they don't play that, and they play king h7, this rook takes here, and even rook check here, next move, and queen there, or rook, or bishop, or whatever, however you want to play it. If you want to play it abstractly, obliquely, and all that sort of thing, go for it. I don't care. It's your choice. You're the one who has the choice over these pieces. But the way the grandmasters played, they resigned after rook d8 check. His opponent resigned after rook d8, which they gave 2 exclamation marks. Now, when you look at it, it looks quite simplistic. But that's the end of the session. And I thank you very much for those that actually do take an interest in what I'm doing here. I have got people that are telling me that I'm an idiot doing this for nothing. But I do it for reasons, because primarily I do it for the physical reason that the person that helped me when I was a young lad helped me without any expense to myself or that of my mother that you've just heard on the phone, or my father. And he was just a painter. And so that's one of the main reasons I do it. Plus it makes me feel good, but I do like to see interest in my videos, and if I don't, well then it sort of can be a wee bit off-putting. Okay, so that's all for me today, and I'm going to leave you with the position at the start, where black played a5, and Donna had seen already, Grandmaster Donna had already seen after bishop c7, rook d4, and that was going to be a good position for white. Okay, thank you very much. All the best with your chess playing antics and that sort of thing. And I'll be back for session 20, week 22, session number 2 tomorrow. Thank you, bye-bye.